Coming up on KCCI 8 News Close Up, the candidates seem to have similar backgrounds, but much different views on solving Iowa's challenges. This morning, we question Liz Mathis and Ashley Hinson about why they should be Iowa's next 2nd District Congresswoman.
This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close Up.
Well, good morning. We're just 23 days away from the November 8th general election. This morning, we continue to interview candidates and get their stances on critical issues that affect you. Now we focus on Iowa's 2nd congressional district race. The two candidates, Republican Ashley Hinson and Democratic challenger Liz Mathis, are well known to many voters there, but were news anchors on Northeastern Iowa television stations. Republican Ashley Hinson is a first-term congresswoman. She won the seat after defeating then-incumbent Democrat Abby Finkenauer in the 2020 election. Prior to that, Hinson served in the Iowa House of Representatives from 2017 to 2021. Hinson currently serves Iowa's 1st District, which covers most of Northeast Iowa. Due to redistricting, she now lives in the 2nd District, which still covers the northeastern part of the state. KCCI's Amanda Rooker spoke with Hinson about her background.
Yeah, so I actually grew up right here in Des Moines, went to Valley High School. My parents actually still live in West Des Moines, so it's nice when I come back to town, I get to stay at what I call the Hinson Hilton, so it's fun to come back. Went to University of Southern California for my undergraduate degree in broadcast journalism. Worked for a year in Colorado on my way back to Iowa, and just wanted to come back to Iowa to raise my family and to continue my career. So I actually anchored news and reported myself in Cedar Rapids TV market, Cedar Rapids, Iowa City, Dubuque, and Waterloo for more than a decade before I decided to get into politics. I've really just enjoyed, it's been my true honor to serve Iowans. I started in the State House, served there for 4 years, and then obviously now I'm just wrapping up my first term in Congress. But my number one job, of course, is to be a good wife and mom. My husband, Matt, and my two boys, Max and Jax, we live in Marion, Iowa. So I'm just really proud to represent Iowans and tell their stories in Washington.
Now, Hinson's opponent is Democratic candidate Liz Mathis. Much like Hinson, before she ran for office, she was a television journalist and anchor. She was also a college teacher at Wartburg and the University of Iowa. She also worked for several nonprofits. In 2011, Mathis won a seat in the Iowa Senate. KCCI's Amanda Rooker sat down with Mathis to learn more about her background.
I grew up on a farm. My parents were World War II veterans, and they really taught me the meaning of leadership. My dad was a no-till farmer back in 1972 when no farmers were doing that. My mom was the town doctor's nurse. She'd gone through the cadet corps in the military, so she was healing a lot of people, and she was delivering a lot of babies. And so I learned really a lot of hard work. Nothing was handed to me. I really had to work at detasseling and mowing a cemetery. And so I took that money and I put it toward schooling. And I went to the University of Iowa, studied journalism, became a journalist for television broadcast journalist for about 30 years for an NBC affiliate in Eastern Iowa, Northeast Iowa, and for an ABC affiliate. In between, I taught at Wartburg College. And then after that, I decided I wanted to do more. So I started working for a children's nonprofit that helps kids who have mental health issues and foster care and special needs adoption and a lot of case management for families that are in crisis. So I worked there and helped social workers tell their stories. And then I decided that I would run for state senate while I was working at this agency. And so I served for 10 years in the Iowa State Senate doing a lot of work around health care policy, around public safety, education, you name it.
Well, next on Close Up, inflation, abortion, and lagging test scores. We'll show you the solutions both candidates are offering. And that starts with Liz Mathis, what she would do in Congress to keep companies from price gouging during sky-high inflation. Welcome back to Close Up. Whichever candidate voters send to Congress, they'll have a lot of issues to deal with. Inflation, abortion rights, gun violence, crime, and falling education scores. Now, we asked both candidates what solutions they'd push if they're elected, starting with inflation. Liz Mathis says she's concerned about some companies making record profits while Americans struggle with higher prices.
So I would say take a look at the supply chain, make sure that we're fixing that we can deliver goods and services. And a price gouging bill came up, and that was alleviating some of those high prices. Ashley Hinson voted against that in Congress. And I would also make sure that we aren't seeing price gouging by the meat packers as well. That affects our farmers who produce the meat. And also, it affects the workers. So we don't want to see higher profits for the companies built on the backs of the workers.
And the next topic is on abortion, something that has been central after the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade. If you were elected, what action would you like to see Congress take to either restrict or expand abortion access?
I would protect reproductive rights at a federal level. We have heard from a majority of Iowans who want their rights protected, and I would support that.
Now, when we talk about reproductive rights and protecting that, what does that look like for you? Is there a certain number of weeks, or is there any kind of minutia that you support in terms of how far to legalize abortion and what action Congress should take?
Well, in Iowa, we have a 20-week ban. So the third trimester, there is no abortion. It is illegal in the state of Iowa to get an abortion in the third trimester. But we want to make sure that all maternal health rights are there too. We want to make sure that there's health for people who have ectopic pregnancies, or they miscarry, or there's a fetal abnormality. And we want to make sure that those who are going into the medical profession, if they're a resident in OBGYN, that they don't have to jump through hoops for requirements to practice maternal health.
The next topic is on addressing education. If you were elected, what action would you want to take to improve Iowa's public education system, but also the country's?
We used to be number one in education. So I think we have to make sure that we're taking into account no harassment and discrimination in our schools, but we have to focus on other things too, like the achievement gap. What happened after COVID? Are we making up for that achievement gap? The kids were out of class for a while. We want to make sure that they're still learning at a rate that's needed for them to succeed. And we also need to make sure that their mental health is addressed. So providing for social workers or for therapists at a high school level or in a public school level, K through 12, there are kids that are suffering at any age. So we want to make sure that they're provided for that. And then, also in education, that we are keeping our schools safe. A lot of superintendents have talked to me about that they're worried that our schools have become, locked doors, and they're not community places anymore. So how do we get back to that? How do we provide for safety and still have a place where the community can meet?
Yeah, and talking about, feeling safe in schools, I think, as kids head back to school, a lot of us are still reflecting on what happened in Uvalde last May, and
yes,
we've seen a number of mass shootings recently. What action do you feel like Congress should take to stop this trend of gun violence in our country?
So I am a supporter of the Second Amendment. I grew up on a farm. We were around guns and hunting. But many of the hunters that were there were very safe with their guns. And we have to promote that to make sure if you are a gun owner, you're being safe with your guns. We want to make sure that collectors are staying safe too, and they're doing the right thing. But we certainly want to promote background checks. I think that the majority of Iowans, and especially Northeast Iowans, support background checks and red flag laws.
Now, the next topic is on a rising violence across the country, mm-hmm. violent crime. What action would you take to tackle that trend?
Well, I think that we certainly have seen some of our public safety officers try to combat the rising crime. Iowa's crime rate is still low, but we want to make sure that we're providing for protection for our citizens. It's number one on my list. So I have voted to increase the number of state troopers. I voted to increase narcotics officers for the state. I voted to make sure that we have drug courts so that people will get the help that they need, you know, when they need rehabilitation. And I was a Gold Star winner of the Iowa Sheriffs and Deputies Association a few years ago. So they voted me in on the issues around mental health and how I was working with law enforcement on mental health services. So I would continue to do the same thing to certainly make sure that we have enough officers to keep us safe.
And the last topic is on something you've already mentioned a little bit about, but on healthcare. I'm wondering, what reform would you like to see on healthcare, and what's your plan to lower prescription drug prices?
Yeah, so healthcare in Iowa, very specific to our rural areas, we need more help. So we have a healthcare worker shortage. We want to make sure that we, beef that up, make sure that that career is offered to high school students and guide them into a healthcare career. We want to make sure there are mental health beds available. Right now, when a child is in crisis or an adult is in crisis in mental health, there are no beds available at times, or the bed is way across the state, and we have to change that. So mental health facilities like the Access Treatment Centers that Johnson County and Linn County have are what I would want to work towards at a federal level to make sure that we're increasing those facilities, that there is access to treatment all across the state of Iowa, if not all across the country. So I'd say mental health care and maternal health care. To try, you know, to deliver a baby in the rural area, a lot of women have to go to larger hospitals far away, and that's a problem.
Coming up on Close Up, we put the same five questions to Ashley Hinson, her plan to help improve falling test scores among Iowa students. Welcome back to Close Up. KCCI put the same five questions of inflation, abortion, gun violence, crime, and falling education scores to Ashley Hinson. We're going to start with inflation. Here's three things Hinson says needs to be done to get sky-high inflation. Oh, sorry, I've messed up too many times. Throw the iPad at me, Aya. Welcome back to Close Up. KCCI put the same five questions of inflation, abortion rights, gun violence, crime, and falling education scores to Ashley Hinson. We start with inflation. Here's three things Hinson says needs to be done to get sky-high inflation under control.
So number one, stop that out of control government spending. Number two, let's make sure we're reinvesting in our supply chain. I've introduced legislation to try to reinvigorate rural manufacturing, remaking those things that are absolutely critical to our supply chain here at home. And then again, focusing on energy independence, restoring those jobs and focusing on that as a national security issue as well. So those are the steps that we can take immediately to help reduce inflation in this country.
Now, the second topic is another one that's been central to, I think, most campaigns this general election cycle on abortion. Now that Roe v. Wade has been overturned, what action, if any, do you think Congress should take to either expand or restrict abortion access?
Yeah. Well, I'm pro-life, and I will continue to fight for pro-life policies in Washington, D.C. I've fought for taxpayers to make sure the Hyde Amendment language is included, which makes sure that no taxpayer funding is going to fund elective abortions, and I think that's absolutely critical. I see the Democrats' position in Washington, D.C. as being extreme on this. They brought to the floor a bill right after that decision was handed down that would allow for elective elective abortion on demand until birth. And I think that's wrong and that's extreme. I'm grateful that we have a very pro-life governor here in Iowa who will continue to fight for those pro-life policies here in Iowa. And I think that that's where those fights belong. I do think that it's important to at least stand up for some babies, you know, at the pain threshold, that 15-week threshold. I just supported a bill that I think would set a standard for that with exceptions, and I'll continue to support those kinds of pro-life policies in Washington. I'm pro-life, and I've always supported exceptions for rape, incest, and life of the mother, fetal anomaly. And those are things that we absolutely need to have a conversation about in Washington, D.C., too.
And turning to the next topic is on education. What action do you believe that Congress should take to improve Iowa and the country's public education system?
Yeah. Well, ultimately, I am a parent myself. I have school-age kids. My boys are 11 and 9 in public school here in Iowa. I want every child to have a great education, no matter where they seek out that education. I think coming out of the pandemic, it's been very, very clear that we've seen people mishandle our public school system across this country. I led the fight in Washington, D.C. with the Reopen Schools Act to try to get all of our kids in this country back in the classroom. We were sending them billions and billions of dollars to reopen. Luckily here in Iowa, our governor and our legislature did that, got kids back in the classroom. But across the country where we saw people take advantage of all that money coming in without accountability, they didn't. And so now what we've seen as a result of that is incredible learning loss in this country. So I'm leading on the Parents' Bill of Rights in Washington, D.C., which is filled with provisions that will just help stand up for parents and make sure they're heard when it comes to their kids' education, and that we continue to focus on getting kids the best education wherever that meets them. And I think that's the conversation we need to be having, because ultimately a public school education may be great for one family. It may not be the right opportunity for another family, and we need to put that power back with the parents.
The next topic is on the rise in violent crime across the country. What's your plan to tackle that trend?
Well, we absolutely need to be standing up to violent crime in our community. It's unacceptable what's happened. You look at some of these cities like New York, Portland, Seattle, Philadelphia, we've seen murders rise and on the increase. Soft on crime rhetoric leads to soft on crime policies lead to increased crime in those communities, and that's exactly what we've seen. So we need to make sure we continue to support our law enforcement. I've been very clear in my stance of supporting our law enforcement, our men and women in blue, our sheriffs.
Now the next topic is on gun violence in the wake of recent mass shootings. You know, as kids head back to school, we're all sort of still thinking about what happened in Uvalde. Do you believe in any sort of gun control measures, or how would you address the rise in gun violence?
Yeah. Well, and I'm absolutely advocating for the right policies in this space because I am a mom, right? I have two kids that I put on the school bus that have to go to school, and I put them on that bus every day hoping that they're going to be safe at school, and I know that they are. I want our schools to be safe places for our kids to go learn and flourish and grow up. I don't think it's right, though, to stomp on people's Second Amendment rights to do that. I think we need to have due process in the law, and if you look at the laws we have on the books, we have due process to be able to make sure guns don't end up in the hands of the wrong people. You talk about soft on crime policies, that's the number one way where guns get into the hands of the wrong people. So we need to make sure we're enforcing the laws on the books, making sure people are speaking up about mental health. That's an area where I've been very passionate about doing work in and providing more increased resources for mental health advocates and with our law enforcement. I've done a ride along with our local sheriff's office where they actually called out the mental health resource officer. So I got a firsthand chance to see how that officer interacted with someone and helped provide them with the services that they needed. So those are areas where I think we need to be prioritizing in this country and having serious conversations. Unfortunately, the plans that the Democrats in Washington, D.C. have put on the floor have violated our constitutional rights, and I just can't support bills that do that.
I was going to ask you about your vote on the Bipartisan Safer Communities Act. You voted no on that. Tell me why you voted no on that.
Again, I think that there were some provisions in there that could violate due process, and we need to be intentional in the language we're putting on the floor. I'm not going to go to Washington, D.C. to just vote on bills that make a great headline or make people feel good. I want real solutions. That wasn't a real solution, and it's not going to actually fix the problem. And so, again, I want resources to be able to help our law enforcement enforce the laws that are on the books and do so in a way that does not violate people's constitutional rights.
Now, the last topic is on health care. What, if any, health care reform do you support? And What's your plan to lower prescription drug prices?
Well, absolutely. When I've heard about the inflation issue from so many people, the cost of prescription drugs is top of mind for so many people. And I'm very serious about this issue because I know it's very serious for our seniors and for so many of the people that I represent. What we've seen in Washington, D.C. is a government price fixing scheme where it won't actually do anything to control the cost of the drugs that people are buying. All it does is pass those costs on. When you cap it, it doesn't do anything. If it's a $35 cap and the drug still costs $75, that doesn't do anything to lower the cost. So what I've supported is a plan that's the Lower Cost, More Cures plan. It's full of 40 different bipartisan provisions that include more transparency on our pharmaceutical companies, allowing our high deductible insurance plans to actually cover things like insulin before that deductible is met, so it provides more flexibility for people to be able to afford those drugs. But it also doesn't do it in a way where it stifles innovation. I just met with somebody last week in Washington, D.C., where they were talking about amazing drugs that they're and technologies that they're developing to help fight all sorts of cancers, not just brain cancers, but ovarian cancer and other kinds.
Next on Close Up, working across the aisle, how Mathis and Hinson say they'll work with their opposition in Congress. Part of the job of any elected official is working with their political opponents to get things done. Now, we asked Ashley Hinson and Liz Mathis how they manage to work across the aisle.
So how do you represent all Iowans, even if they disagree with you politically?
Yeah, well, and there will be issues that we, of course, passionately disagree on, but I think I've done a great job representing a lot of different viewpoints because I go everywhere all the time and go connect with Iowans where they are. I've done 20 town halls, one in every county that I currently represent. I'll continue to get out and reach out to Iowans in every aspect of the district. I've spoken to every socioeconomic status of taxpayer, I've met with farmers groups and agriculture commodity groups. So I've literally reached out to everyone to hear their stories, and we may not always agree, but I am going to take that feedback back and try to do the most good for the most people, and that's what I've delivered on in Washington, D.C. I'm the only Iowan on the Appropriations Committee, which is very important because ultimately when it comes to government spending and respecting taxpayer dollars, which is my number one job and my number one goal is to advocate for taxpayers, I've been able to deliver reinvestment back in the district in a very targeted way. And so I think that's why, you know, when I look at the district and what I'm doing to make sure I'm getting out there and earn every single vote, I will continue to do that because that's what Iowans expect.
If you were elected, how would you represent all Iowans, even those who, you know, may passionately disagree with you on politics?
Absolutely. I think my record explains that. So as a state senator, I was very bipartisan. I voted with the Republicans. I voted with the Democrats. I voted with the Republicans on tax bills like cutting commercial property tax and raising earned interest tax, you know, tax credits for people who were working and making sure that we would make costs lower for people. And so I voted on public safety bills where I was, you know, protective of certainly training for police officers. And we voted to increase state troopers' salaries and more state troopers on the roads. We voted about narcotics officers and drug court. And so, you know, I think my record proves itself that I would work for anyone who, you know, came to me.
It is hard to believe, but we're just 23 days away from the November 8th general election, and that means there are a number of deadlines coming up you need to know about. Early voting begins here in Iowa Wednesday, October 19th. That means you can cast an absentee ballot during business hours at your county auditor's office or at a designated satellite voting station. Early voting continues through November 7th. October 19th is also the day county auditors start mailing out absentee ballots to voters who requested them. If you want an absentee ballot mailed to your home, you must have a ballot request form at your county auditor's office by Monday, October 24th at 5 p.m. That's also the deadline to register to vote. You can do that online or by mail. Remember, Election Day is on Tuesday, November 8th. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you back here next week, same time. Well, part of the job of any elected official is working with their political opponents to get things done. We asked Ashley Hinson and Liz Mathis how they manage to work across the aisle.
So how do you represent all Iowans, even if they disagree with you politically?
Yeah, well, and there will be issues that we, of course, passionately disagree on, but I think I've done a great job representing a lot of different viewpoints because I go everywhere all the time and go connect with Iowans where they are. I've done 20 town halls, one in every county that I currently represent. I'll continue to get out and reach out to Iowans in every aspect of the district. I've spoken to every socioeconomic status of taxpayer, I've met with farmers groups and agriculture commodity groups. So I've literally reached out to everyone to hear their stories, and we may not always agree, but I am going to take that feedback back and try to do the most good for the most people, and that's what I've delivered on in Washington, D.C. I'm the only Iowan on the Appropriations Committee, which is very important because ultimately when it comes to government spending and respecting taxpayer dollars, which is my number one job and my number one goal is to advocate for taxpayers, I've been able to deliver reinvestment back in the district in a very very targeted way. And so I think that's why, you know, when I look at the district and what I'm doing to make sure I'm getting out there and earn every single vote, I will continue to do that because that's what Iowans expect.
If you were elected, how would you represent all Iowans, even those who, you know, may passionately disagree with you on politics?
Absolutely. I think my record explains that. So as a state senator, I was very bipartisan. I voted with the Republicans. I voted with the Democrats. I voted with the Republicans on tax bills like cutting commercial property tax and raising earned interest tax, you know, tax credits for people who were working and making sure that we would make costs lower for people. And so I voted on public safety bills where I was, you know, protective of certainly training for police officers. And we voted to increase state troopers' salaries and more state troopers on the roads. We voted about narcotics officers and drug court. And so, you know, I think my record proves itself that I would work for anyone who, you know, came to me.
Well, before Election Day, here's some voting deadlines to be aware of. Early voting begins here in Iowa Wednesday, October 19th. That means you can cast an absentee ballot during business hours at your county auditor's office or at designated satellite voting stations. Early voting continues through November 7th. October 19th is also the day county auditors start mailing out absentee ballots to voters who requested them. If you want an absentee ballot mailed to your home, you must have a ballot request form at your county auditor's office by Monday, October 24th at 5 p.m. That's also the deadline to register to vote. You can register online or by mail. Election Day is Tuesday, November 8th. Absentee ballots need to be at your county auditor's office by that time. That polls close on Election Day. Thank you for joining us. Have a great day.